Well, we're very honored, obviously, to have a very inspiring and great mind with us, Mr. Herbert Deutsch. Now I'm gonna kick us off with my, this isn't what I do. I'm not a Q&A guy. I'm not a public speaker. Herb's better at it than I am, but I put some decent questions together. I'm gonna be pretty lame and unstylish about how I read them because I don't want to miss anything, and Herb's gonna do most of the talking anyway because, he knows the stuff that I don't. So, how are you?
I'm fine. And you have to tell me if we have a microphone. I don't think we need it.
Can everyone
hear? Be here?
Or is this loud? Is this thing on? I had to do it.
It's on.
I can hear it really easily back here.
Flash your lighter if you can hear me in the back.
I don't.
Oh, that's not that bad, actually.
I don't mind. That's a little rush. Yeah. I don't mind holding a mic, but that's fine. And because I don't like to really. I don't like to project. Talk to you like you're in my classroom.
You're not equating anyway.
It's more important that you hear Herb than me anyway. Once again.
Yeah. Thank you, and it's really a pleasure being here. It really is. I was very pleased when the good doctor asked me if I would be interested in coming down and just meeting his class. And I said yes, absolutely, I would. And I'm sort of in the neighborhood. I'm a New Yorker, a Long Islander, and it's not a big deal to drive here at this hour. There are times when we don't think about if we're wanting to get onto Grand Central Parkway at all. But I was very pleased to be asked to come and meet you. So I'm going to give the microphone over, and you can get started with. Well, one of the things you'll find out is that I'll never answer his question the way, exactly the same way that he asked it anyway, but that may not be true.
Okay. We'll give it a shot.
Yes.
Well, I started with the more obvious questions, and probably one you've been asked many times, but who or what has brought you to the wonderful life of music that you've had? Is there a person or?
I'm not going to answer that question about the microphone, but I will. Because, first of all, I must have always liked music. I don't remember when I was 1 year old or 2 years old, but I remember when I was three, very clearly. And by that time, I remember that my mother and father had taken me to a concert. And honestly, I'll tell you a story that I don't remember because I was little, And then I'll tell you a story that I do remember because I was little and scared. The one I don't remember is my father woke my mother up and said, somebody's playing the theme from the Haydn Surprise Symphony. And my mother listened, and she said, oh my God, I don't remember this. But they don't lie. I mean, they didn't lie. They certainly, they never told me this story until I was much older. But I there's a piano in the house where I lived in I had a very poor family. We owned a barely working chicken farm. And so I was born on a chicken farm, which was barely working. but they did take me to hear some orchestra, and it wasn't like it was a local orchestra, I'm sure. In Baldwin, Long Island, But they told me that I had gotten to this piano, that we had a wreck of a piano, and I picked out and then that's the story. I'm sure it was true, but I don't remember. Now I'll tell you the story I remember, because I was 3 years old. We had a garage. At that time, garages were not, you know, part of the house. There was a chicken farm. We had a garage in the back, and my dad parked his Humvee over there. And if you want to look that up, you'll know definitely how old I am. But I was out there by myself, and I had a stick in my hand. I remember this absolutely clearly. I had a big stick like that, and I was hitting it on the floor. And I was hitting it, and as I was hitting it, I heard it playing. I knew my ear, I heard C, D, E, depending on where I moved this, hit the stick. So I knew, and I was just doing that, and I liked doing it, and all of a sudden, my real brain came in, and I remember thinking, it's the same sound. And I remember that is the first memory that I had of being really scared. I suddenly knew that this was happening, and I was just, and yet I knew I heard boom, 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 whatever I heard was doing. I was playing things.
Right.
And when I got scared, I remember throwing a stick down, running into the house, and telling my mother what happened to me. You know, and she the only thing she knew is, we're going to get a piano lesson.
Right.
But that's where it really began.
And your parents were supportive of this?
They were supportive of it. I mean, that piano played a little part in my life, also very early, because it was an absolute horrible, horrible piano. And they got, as a piano teacher, a 16-year-old girl whose father ran a, a barber. His father was a barber. And this kid was his daughter. And her name was Marianne Matthews.
So you said
she was 16 years old and she played piano and she was in high school and they told her that she was a good piano player.
She was the one who actually
told me what to do with my hands. You know?
Right.
So, and when I was five, I did start with a better teacher. One of my uncles helped us financially at that point.
Right. So. Now you said you banged the stick. Did that no pun intended. Did that resonate into you creating, other than the piano? Were you a creative person? Did you make a lot of stuff?
Yeah, I love to make things. At that age, my family knew if they wanted to get me a nice present, for whatever, a birthday or a Christmas present. And that's another hand. And the other thing, which is part of creativity, is I was born in a Jewish family, but we always had a Christmas tree.
Us too.
My father was a real my mother was from a Viennese family, and they had Christmas in Vienna. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were, we know history, and when you think about it now, I don't want to get into that whole historical thing, but we didn't, as far as I remember, we were not feeling bad being Jewish. My father didn't want to believe in any religion, and he thought he was Karl Marx. He always had something to say about religion being the opiate of the masses. I found out that Karl Marx had said it, and my father was quoting it.
So I didn't know that. You passed me
correctly. But this piano that we had was absolutely a wreck, and we put it outside in an outside porch, and they had pulled the front of it, you know, and I put a piano, and they had pulled it, and I remember when I absolutely was no more than 5 years old, loving to get inside that piano and play on the strings. I remember that, that is a cool sound.
Yeah.
Why aren't we learning these sounds, you know, what you can do with this piano?
So you think the experience with the resonating bass and playing with this string, you think that's what turned you on to synthesizers?
Well, I think it did.
Because you can get tones out of the piano that you certainly can't get when you're beating on it.
Yeah, no, it was just the idea of discovering that the piano has other sounds.
Right.
And that there are other sounds.
And preparing the piano also to change the attack of the note.
Yeah, sure. I have an older brother, and I'm happy to say that my older brother is 93 years old now, and he was an engineer and a mathematician. The family definitely was my brother, but my brother gave me for my 16th birthday a present, and I didn't know anything about it until I got home. I got up and looked outside in the driveway of my house, and this was no longer the chicken farm, but. And we had this little house, and in the driveway was a chassis of a 1929 Plymouth. A chassis. Now, in those days, you know, the car, a chassis was a complete. It had an engine, had a radiator on it, it had an engine, it had a steering column and a steering wheel. And that's it. And my brother said, "Happy birthday. Build yourself a car."
Wow.
And I thought that was the most amazing and incredible present.
Right.
So you asked me about liking to build things. I drew it, designed what I wanted to do. I decided I was trying to imitate a fishtailed Woburn, which was a car that was made early in the 1930s. How do you make a fishtailed car? Well, I started drawing pictures, and I thought, I'll make it out of aluminum. And so I went out and I bought sheets of aluminum, and then realizing, how do you hold things together? Of course, I mean, that's all part of it.
Right.
I mean, you know, this is what you guys are doing.
Exactly.
But this is a different world. And so with the sheets of aluminum, I bought, of course, something to cut the aluminum, and I went out and I bought a big piece of steel, great big piece of iron, great big, great big, I'm thinking, probably 3 or 4 inches big. And then I found some place to sell rivets. And so I drilled every rivet in the body. The whole body was put together by drilling holes, designing the thing, and then standing there with my hand behind it and banging the rivet in one at a time. And the thing that I'm so happy about, it was a terrible car really when it was finished, but I went to junkyard, I put lights and set up all the electricity, I bought seats, and I literally finished the car, and even in New York State, I got a license. I did actually drive the car I made when I was 16. Mm-hmm. It was not a racing car. It was just a 1929 Plymouth.
That was learning a series, because when you take the larger project you take on, which is something we talked about in class, that you learn a lot from a big project.
Oh, yeah.
You know? So would you say that sets you up for making.
I think it absolutely set me. I also knew at the time that the car that I made was not like a fine car. You know, I knew I was a kid, you know, and I was very pleased and proud to have gotten this thing, especially when I got license plates that I could put on it and actually drive it.
You know, we should talk about where we're sitting here a little bit. And Corona Park, and I know that Bob lived close to here at one point. point.
Yeah, he did. He lived in Flushing.
And a lot of simultaneously the fair and synthesizers, for my knowledge, kind of happened at the same moment. When does that land here in lovely Corona, Queens?
As soon as I heard, I really do back up a little bit. As soon as I heard electronic music, but I had already heard the writings of Edgar Varèse about the things that he had built musically, and the greatest enthusiast of all was John Cage. I mean, yeah, like everybody else, I listened to his 4 minutes and 33 seconds. But I listened to John Cage and listened to what he had to say right away, as soon as I was in college. John Cage totally knocked me out. Edgar Varèse was the biggest wonderful experience of my life. I went to college, and at a college here on Long Island called Hofstra University, where technically I still teach. I'm actually in teaching now in my 54th year of teaching college. I love it. I mean, it's not that I think Hofstra's the greatest thing in the world, it's just I love to teach.
But Hofstra's great.
And I have a little more class to teach. When I was listening, the stuff I was listening to in the 1950s, that's when I was in school. And someone told me that there was a new magazine in New York called the Intro Bulletin of the Arts. It never existed. They had one issue, and beyond that, it disappeared. But in that issue, I interviewed Edgar Varèse at his house twice and got to talk to him, and he was telling me about the stuff that he was exploring in electronic music. And I was going into his little room that he had two Ampex tape recorders. And,
primarily tone oscillation?
Yeah.
Or
yeah, it was
test equipment used.
Well, if you're familiar with the famous piece of his poem, Electronique, so it's a little hard to put. It's a little hard to talk about that in any one way. My head was in that world right away.
Right.
I wanted.
It's like a paradigm shift.
I wanted sound. I wanted that stick to really work.
Gotcha.
Whatever that means. If that makes sense.
Was the single issue? Is this when you first saw the Theremin advertisements? Or,
yeah.
There was.
Yeah, yeah.
So the single issue that comes out of a magazine has an advertisement for Build Your Own Theremin.
That was actually a little while.
So if that magazine didn't have it.
It was actually a little while.
Okay, so tell us about that.
Modern popular electronics or something like that.
Okay.
And they did an article. And the article came out in 1961, that's when it was published. And on the cover was this tall, thin man that I had never met, and he was standing in front of the theremin. And he said, build your own theremin. This is from the article. It's one page in the article.
Right.
And it has Bob's circuitry
right.
for the first, his for theremin that
yeah,
he was building.
And you had built one?
I built one of the ones that he was selling.
Okay. Oh,
after
so
I read that article.
So you bought you bought the kit.
$49.50.
Yeah. Yeah.
I bought the kit because I said, wow, I could do this.
Now, do you feel like I was just saying to you, do you feel that you learned something? Was that a musical instrument initially,
oh,
or did you learn something about circuitry?
It was both.
Right.
I mean, I love putting things together, but I didn't really know circuitry.
Right.
And so I read his directions, but once you read the directions, you understand sort of what you're doing.
Right.
You know, and I was always interested in making things. but I really never found a guy to study with like this who's literally teaching what circuitry is all about, you know, and how to use it correctly. Yes, I managed to do things without burning my fingers on them. or getting weird shocks or anything
right.
like that. So
you buy the kit.
Yeah.
And you build the kit, and I've sold kits in the past, and I don't usually wind up developing new musical industries with the people who buy kits. I mean, how did a relationship develop out of a purchase?
It was a wonderful chance meeting, which some of you may have read about or heard about, but it was in 1963. And I had already gotten my job at Hofstra, and you know as whatever the lowest ranking.
But you were there.
called an instructor. They didn't use the term professor at that time until you reached the third level. But I was interested in what was going on in New York State in music to schools. I just was interested, so I went. In 1963, I went to the NISMA All-State Convention. If you're a New Yorker, you're familiar with the name NISMA, which just stands for New York State School Music Association. And it's one of the reasons why music education in New York is very good. You know, it's got a lot. It's got a lot of faults, but it's very competitive. But I went up there and I wanted to hear the All-State band or the All-State kids, the chorus or whatever. I never get to hear the All-State band or chorus or orchestra that year. The first thing I did is I was walking around looking at stuff, and there was a room where people were showing off their products. And I walked into that room and there was this tall, thin man who I recognized from the magazine, and the room was filled, if you haven't heard this story, I have to tell it. The room was filled with theremins and tubas. That's it. They were selling theremins, kits, and tubas. The person who was selling the tubas was not me. But there were tubas all over the place, and Bob Moog was just walking around tubas talking about the theremin. And there was nobody else there, and he and I just started talking.
Was he excited that you had bought the kit?
Absolutely.
Right. It's great when you find someone out in the real world.
Yeah. we talked about that. And then I said to him, of course, you know, by this time I had heard a lot of John Cage and Edgar Valdez. And I said, well, Bob, are you doing anything in electronic music using that term? And Bob said, I don't really know much about electronic music. And he said, he never gave me the opinion that he was not a wonderful engineer. I mean, we were talking about theremins, and he was talking to me about, you know, ways of making it better and things of that sort. But most, when I talked about electronic music, he said, well, you have an example?